everyone. My name is Mond, and I'm the founder of United Make, a multidisciplinary design studio that we really use design to tackle the challenges of the 21st century. Now, I know I'm the last speaker tonight, so I'm sure you're all wired up and geared up, but today, I'm going to share with you some experiments, the things that we do in our studio, and hopefully it will inspire, maybe question, maybe provoke, but I just want to share some ideas with you. Now, I'd love to invite every single one of you to my studio in Melbourne. Unfortunately, we're in Sydney, so I'll try and bring it here for you. We're situated behind a traditional furniture company, and this is an average day that sort of happens. We teach at Melbourne University about architecture, and you can see the clock going, and this is how we sort of work. Quite hard, quite collaboratively, and you can see a drawing machine that we built just drawing at the back. So yeah, we move around a lot, we ask a lot of questions, it's really collaborative, and it's really hidden behind a furniture store. Now in our studio, we have a lot of toys. So we have like laser cutters, CNC machines, 3D printers, virtual reality headsets, green screens, and we always have an open collaborative office where we're like, there's no dumb idea, it's just the time and place to ask it. And today, I'm just telling you a bit of context of how we work, but also the things that we do. So, can design help reduce waste? How many of you out here drink coffee? Can I show you, see your hand? Okay. Well, I'm an avid coffee drinker coming from Melbourne, and I drink about 3 cups a day. But did you know that 3,000 tons of waste is being produced every year in Sydney alone? And we have a really good relationship with our barista. She doesn't like us going to any other store, and she writes messages on our cups. And every night, she comes out with these 2 bags full of this stuff. The stuff you see when they throw it out. And one day, we're like, we could do something with this. So we took this back into our studio, and we mixed it with everything you can think of, like glues, gelatins, concrete. This is just like, what, 1/100th of the stuff of samples that we did? And we actually happened by accident to make a concoction that will cause the coffee grounds to grow with the material that we mixed it with. It gave a really quite unique texture. And we showcased this at TEDx last year at Melbourne. We did this for Melbourne Knowledge Week, but after the reaction, it happens quite quickly. We made a mold for it, and we'll grow into the mold as well. And they actually became recycled coffee ground lampshades. And they give off a little coffee smell about 2 weeks afterwards, but then they stay just as a lampshade. And if you guys are ever in Circular Quay, do you guys know Zumbo? Yeah? You could probably take your date there and impress them by saying that, did you know that these coffee grounds are made from recycled coffee ground lampshades? Yeah? Just an excuse to take your friend there. Okay. Here's another question for you. How many of you guys use YouTube? Yeah? I do. I learn a lot from YouTube, actually. I learned a lot more from YouTube when I was at school than what my teachers taught me. Do you know what the most popular YouTube video is in currently? Does anybody know? Sorry? No, it's not Gangnam Style. Can I take another one? Yes? No, it's not. Can I take another one? Despacito. That is correct. Despacito is the number one. Number two is Shape of You by Ed Sheeran. And the third of is that Fast and Furious one. I'm not sure. But top 10 is Gangnam Style. Justin Bieber, just some guy, right? But do you know where these things that we upload go? Did you know that every second that I'm talking, 6.6 hours of content is being uploaded globally, right? 6.6 hours, like right now, another 6.6. Where does it all go? Data centers. There's a physicality to all this digital content that we're doing. So when Google asked us to make an artwork for their office in Singapore, we really wanted to show the hardware to tell the story. And rather than me telling it, there's a film. Fun at the Google office in Singapore as well. I just took some computers. So we actually sourced 30 donations of e-waste. That was a CD drive that people don't use anymore. And we really wanted to showcase the physicality behind the screen. So these would be shared. And what we did was we actually took hard drives and put Despacito. We put Shape of You by Ed Sheeran. All on hard drives on this as a physical manifestation at YouTube. And now I would like to take you to another place. A place all across the world called Atenolto. An island on the east coast of Mexico where illegal mining happens. Where rare earth minerals are dug up. And these minerals are used to be processed into our phones, laptops, electronic devices, Otanif is harvested to make our phones load milliseconds faster. There's a Wikipedia article online that you can read about. There's videos of YouTube about the landscapes that was there. And also images online of what was there before. But today, these are the people, these are the places, and the phones that you're holding is what is sold to us. Have you ever considered where your phones are made? How much of the world we hold in our pockets? And how we're able to view these places on the devices that are causing these places? Just want that to sit in for a little bit. Now, Atenolto is entirely fictional. It's actually made up. From its name, its narrative, its images, its place, it's actually designed through a more modern-day understanding of place, a place on the internet and the flickering of screens. So throughout history, we've always created fictional places, like Atlantis, El Dorado, Sandy Island. One belief about Atlantis was that Plato, being a master storyteller, used to tell the politicians of Greece that the people of Atlantis got so greedy and corrupt that the gods punished them and sent them to the bottom of the ocean. Plato using Atlantis as a cautionary tale. Atenolto is a phantom island designed for the internet. We as architects and designers are now able to create places without them being physically manifested. So how many of you use Google Earth and Google Maps? Yeah, I did to get here, right? But how does it work? How much do you trust in these systems? So I did a little experiment. So Panoramio is a third-party plugin that actually uploads images that Google collects. So I initially started by uploading sky images, because how can you tell the difference between a Sydney sky and a Melbourne sky? That got accepted. Then I started mismatching my location, so I put Mexico in London and London in Mexico. That got accepted. Then I started Photoshopping. You guys know what Photoshop is, right? Yeah? So I started Photoshopping images. And then I went so far, I started rendering them from complete scratch. So they're all made up. And in 2013, I wrote to Google. I was like, "Dear Google, this island without a name is called Adit Nolta." I waited a week, and they responded. They said, "Congratulations. We have made changes based on your suggestions. Happy mapping." So I thought it was only logical to make a website, talk about the island, push this fiction along a bit more. Create a Wikipedia article. Have people add to it and make it more real. I made a trailer about it that you can watch online about the people and how they struggled and how it actually manifested this island. And then through webcam travel, I made a stage set model that was live streamed onto Google Earth. It referenced the informal places around the world where illegal mining would happen, as well as Mexico cities. And this project got so far that a National Geographic photographer contacted me. You guys know what National Geographic, oh yeah, yeah. And he goes, "Mond, tell me, is this place safe to travel?" So the really thing that I want you to really understand is that we are currently living in an information era where there's so much information out there. But how much of it can you trust, right? How much do you just take for granted, right? All right, I've got one last project to tell you. What do we breathe? Now, this is a map of the world's NO2 levels, the stuff that's in pollution. And the red areas are where there's heavily polluted smog, and the blue is where you're clear. And we're pretty safe, right? Like, yeah, in general, we're not as bad as China or America, right? But where is all our stuff made? How much are we really connected? Actually, we're as bad as China from like living and consuming products. In China, there's a really bad smog. My family actually comes from China. And who signed up for early signs of lung cancer, cardiovascular disease? And as a designer, what can I really do? So there was a competition for a sculpture to be done in the Bund in Shanghai. And rather than making a pretty object as what you probably think a sculpture is, or a metaphor or a symbol for something, we really wanted it to be performative. So we combined the form as well as the material to filter the air. And what it would do was take the NOx and SOx, and when it reacts, it will release CO2 and oxygen. Of course, this is not going to solve the problems of the world's global pollution, but it starts a conversation, right? It brings more awareness about it. And this sculpture ages. So as the CO2 is released, it starts to grow moss and greenery on it so that it starts to become a small little mountain and hill that ages, and that also filters the air. Now, one thing I want to leave you with today is probably a quote that I really, really love. "There are no passengers on spaceship Earth. We are all crew." I think we live in this globe where we're all connected with people, but we really need to think about what our purposes are and what we can really add to humanity. And where does it all really start? By experiments, by small little ideas, from recycled coffee ground lampshades to making fictional islands on Google to bring awareness about how much we can trust in technology. So can you promise me one thing? I know you're probably exhausted and it's the end of the day and you've seen so many fantastic speakers before me. Can you promise me one thing? That you would do what is right and not what is easy. Yeah? Can you do that for me? Yeah? Because you are the future of what is to come. Yeah? We live in strange times right now where the jobs that are coming out are probably going to be invented by you. and then you can hire me to create more fictional islands. You know? And thank you.
Thank you.